The title of my talk today is Advancing Society Through Scientific Research, Needs and Trends. The first question we ask is, why do we do research? Of course, most of us are from academia, and some of us are from research centers or industry, and we know that we need to do it. But there is another way to look at the need for to do research. It's a question that was asked to Al Schaefer, the acting US Assistant Secretary for Defense for Research and Engineering. He was asked, what are you doing to encourage industry to spend more on independent research and development? Here he had a very interesting way to look at it. He answered by going back to 2008. At that time, there was a downtrend in economy. It impacted many countries around the world, and of course, it impacted the United States. The auto industry is a very important part of the US economy, and it is a major part of the operation for the city of Detroit and the state of Michigan. And of course, it suffered heavily. At that time, the United States government wanted to improve and to help the US auto industry to recover and to pass through the depression period. The US industry wanted to give loans to the four major industrial companies in the US in auto industry. These are General Motors, Chrysler, Ford, and of course the Ford is not fully US, but because of its major operation was included, that's Toyota. When the US government offered the loans opportunity to these companies, two of them accepted it and they needed it. These are General Motors and Chrysler. Two refused it and they didn't want it. These are Ford and Toyota. When people went back, the economists went back and tried to analyze what happened, what are the differences between these companies, they found that General Motors and Chrysler, they cut their spending, their investment in research and development about 10 years before, while Ford and Toyota, they kept their spending levels, which led to the conclusion that the companies that cut their investment in research and development, they actually committed suicide. And it only took 10 years for that action to catch up with them, while the companies Ford and Toyota, who kept spending and they kept healthy spending level, they were able to adapt, be ready for any down trend, and that's how they kept themselves moving and alive. That leads us to the next question. Why do we do research, or what are the advantages of research from academic point of view? Of course, the most obvious one is technical innovation. It brings new ideas, new technologies, and improvement to industry. Knowledge integration. For those who teach, you know that the best way for you to encourage students to understand new issues is to develop a research project around this point, and this will help them to understand the point, and sometimes even to see what goes on between two different fields. Interdisciplinary collaborations. When we look at most of the developments today, we will see it not really happening in the core of an established field of science. Most of it happens on the overlap area between two areas, between physics and biology, between computer science and social studies. And I can give you so many examples. Even when you look at most of the new journals that get approved right now by organizations like IEEE, you will find that they involve several societies, which means the new coming areas are really on the overlap between two established fields. Also, research leads to industrial collaboration and technology transfer. That's an added value for cooperation between university and industry. For students as well as for researchers, it leads to teamwork, and that's something very much needed. And at the end, even between countries, it leads to people integration. Now, with that said, since research benefits everybody, why do government need to support it? Because it brings several advantages for their societies. The most important one from government point of view is development of human resources. When we do research, we do generate new knowledge, we do generate papers, we do generate many ideas. But for research, when it's done at a university, the most important product is the students and the researchers who are trained in a university. They go outside and they work for 20, 30, or 40 more years producing to society. That's the most important product or outcome from research in a university. From when you look at it from government point of view, that's where industry get a return on their investment. Due to the competition right now, countries, when they compete at the industrial level. While many companies, you cannot really identify their international identity. We just said Toyota, even though it's a Japanese company, United States government considered part of US economy because of its contribution. With that said, with all the distribution centers, distributed fabrication, every country that gets a piece of that industry must keep it ahead. Otherwise, the main manufacturer will take it away and move it to another country because they will get two or a few dollars saving on cost. Globalization of industry, that's a major reason for universities also and for government to invest in research. Because like we said, if you don't invest, you will lose your lead, and whatever you have today will move to another country tomorrow because of cheap labor, cheap production, and so on. When we look at what's going on around the world right now in terms of spending and research and development, you will see that Asia and the 20 countries there are the largest spenders in research and development. Between 2012 to 2014, they were spending somewhere in the neighborhood of $600 billion per year, a little bit more right now. America, 21 countries, they are spending something in the neighborhood of about $500 billion. Europe, 34 countries, they're spending a little bit less than 400,000. And here is the most troubling part. The rest of the world does not really contribute much. And at the same time, there is a lesson there. When you look at these three areas, these are the leading in economy, leading in development, leading in everything. The rest of the world is struggling. When you look a little bit deeper, even beyond the surface, to see what's happening. Even though we said the Americas spend about one third of research expenditure in the world, most of it is coming from the United States, about 31% of the 33%. And that's why you notice the development in the Americas, happening most of it in the United States. When you look at the Asian countries, China leading, spending about 17.5% of the world expenditure on research. And what's the fastest growing country right now in research and development? It's China. Japan, even though it retreated a little bit, but still has a healthy share of research and development, 10.2%. And that's why Japan is able to maintain its leading position right now. India, that's not bad. Of course, it's way behind China and Japan. And also, this reflects its position. As unfortunately, India is lagging behind these two countries whilst catching up, but not fast enough. In Europe, not surprising, Germany spending about 5.7% of the world expenditure, research, and development. That's why Germany is the leader in Europe. For the Middle East, I think I will comment on it in the next graph because it tells the story in more detail. This is a busy graph, but really it tells you the complete story. Let's analyze it a little bit. On the x-axis, or on the horizontal axis, we see research and development as percentage of the gross domestic product. So every country, or actually the leading countries in the world, every one of them is represented by a circle. You see it here. If you take the center of the circle and drop down, you will see the percentage of their spending on research and development as a percentage of their gross domestic product. On the vertical axis, you will see the number of scientists and engineers per million in that country, which shows their working force. The size of the circle itself represents the magnitude of spending on research and development. The color is a code that represents the region. North America is blue, Europe is orange, Asia Pacific is yellow. Let's look at some of these countries and try to analyze their position. The largest circle here, you see United States, and it's spending close to 3% of its gross domestic product on research and development. That's why United States is able, at least up to this point, to maintain its position. And because of that, when you look at United States, it has about 5,000 scientists and engineers per million of its population. Given the fact that its population is close to 300 million, that shows you how many scientists and engineers are there. The next country is China. That's the second largest circle. And that shows China is the fastest growing country right now in research and development. And that, of course, reflects back on its growth in its economy. As percentage of its domestic products, close to 2%. The number of scientists and engineers per million, it's low, it's about 1,000. But given the fact that the population of China is huge, that's probably maybe it is the highest in the world in one country. Next one, you see Japan. It's the size of the circle is not bad at all. Because it's a smaller country, even though it spends about $10 billion per year on research, sorry, not $10 billion, 10% of the world expenditure on research and development, it's a huge chunk of their economy. It's about 3.5%. The number of research and engineers per million, it's high compared to the United States, is 5,000. But of course, because if it's a smaller population, the total number of scientists and engineers is smaller. When you move to the Middle East, let me look for some countries. Probably one of the best countries in the Middle East in terms of spending on research and development is Israel. It spends about 4.25% of gross domestic product on research and development. That's really very significant. It shows how much commitment they have for research and development. But at the same time, because it's a smaller country, the 4.5% does not really give it a very large circle. The number of scientists and engineers is close to 1,800. With that, let's look at Turkey, which is here. The size of the circle is comparable to Israel, which tells us that Turkey really spends a significant component of its economy on research and development, but it's a smaller percentage. But since it's a larger country, it makes up for it. The number of scientists and engineers in Turkey per million, it's a little bit less than 1,000, which is less than Israel. But since the population of Turkey is about 65 to 70 million, they make up for it and they have a respectable number. Other countries from the Middle East, you have Qatar here. Not bad in terms of spending on research and development. Not bad on the size, but they lack the infrastructure. They lack in the number of scientists and engineers. And here you have Saudi Arabia. This is India. And I leave this graph, really. This graph tells a lot about what goes on in the world. In terms of government support and the way it manages research and development, I just want to focus on two countries. There's no point of trying to go to many of them. The first country I will talk about is Japan and what they do to manage research and development. Japan, of course, it has a prime minister. With the prime minister, there is a minister of state for science and technology policy. And with that, there is something called Japanese Science and Technology Agency. That's the equivalent of for what we have in US is the National Science Foundation. I'll comment about in a minute. And that's the agency that really manages research and development for them. What they have, what we call it virtual operation. Virtual operation means the Science and Technology Agency does not have laboratories of its own. It supports or it gives funds to universities, to research centers to develop future ideas. And with that also, they have something called Ministry of Education, Culture, Sports, Science, and Technology. When I looked at this combination, on the first look, it looked weird to me. Just look at what they have: education, culture, sports, science, and technology. But when I try to think what's in common between all of them, it is the future. That's what they are doing. They are investing in their future. Education, culture, sports, these are things that appeal to future generation and to their youth. And of course, with it, they are investing in science and technology. What the Japan Science and Technology Agency doing? It promotes creation of science and technology, science, technology, innovation, develop virtual networking research institutes, and these are some of their strategies. Promote strategic basic research, commercialize research and development outcomes of academia and industry collaboration, which means they don't just do research to publish paper and put it on the shelves. They need to feed, to take it and get it to feed to something else, to the next step. Contribute reconstruction from disasters. And we all know what happened to Japan a few years ago when they were hit with that tsunami and they had a nuclear disaster there. In principle, if it happened to another country, the country probably would be in shambles by now, and maybe several years later they will still suffer from that nuclear explosion that happened there. But for Japan, they recovered from it. Why? Because they had the infrastructure. They had the foundation to deal with it. What Japan Science Technology is doing, promote global collaboration of R&D, and that's something Japan is doing it very well. They really are open to collaborate with the rest of the world because they realize they cannot do it all by themselves. They need help. Support utilization of intellectual property of research. Intellectual property is another important piece of what comes out of research, and that's how they can turn it into funds. I will try to move a little bit in terms of time, and I will move to the other side of, I will mention two countries on what they do in research. The first one was Japan, and now I'll talk about United States. United States has an interesting story in how they moved to where they are right now. In the 19th and early 20th century, United States government was not involved in supporting research and development. They were leaving it all for individuals. And in the early 1920, between 26 to 1930, Herbert Hoover, who was at the time US Secretary of Commerce, tried to think about that the government should really try to get to support research. And in his opinion, he felt, if the US government does not do this, then US as a country will be parasite, will be paralyzed because of that. Because if the government does not support research, then there will be three ways for government to advance, for the country to advance itself in terms of basic research. Number one, the rest of the world would bear the burden of fundamental discovery. And that basically was happening. When you think about most discoveries in the 19th and 19th century and early 20th century, it was happening here in Europe, in France, United Kingdom, Germany, Italy. Very little of it was in the United States. And probably when you think about the 19th century, the most important inventor at the time was Thomas Edison. And when you think about Thomas Edison, he was not really involved in basic research. He did not generate new knowledge. Thomas Edison built his empire as a developer. He takes ideas, and then he turns them into inventions, and inventions make money. So he's at the far end of research, which is turning inventions into dollars, but not at the front end of research, which is generating new knowledge. The other approach the United States could have used to generate new knowledge is universities themselves, would they do it? And of course, in principle, universities are private, independent entities, and therefore they could do it on their own, away from the government. The third possibility, which is some benevolent people like Smithsonian, Carnegie, or Rockefeller, people who are wealthy, they will come back and they donate from their own wealth to build or to make endowment which will support the society. And in all three cases, government is not involved in this. And whoever felt that that system itself cannot be sustained, and therefore government must go back and find ways to support research. When he tried to do this, he formed a group, and there was a conclusion that not everybody was in favor of government supporting research. And some of the discussions or arguments were presented as we see them here. If government financial support should carry with it government control of research programs or research workers, which would happen when government supports something, it controls it. So that was fear number one. Fear number two, that when government supports research, this could lead to political influence or lobbying for distribution of funds. That refers to what the research people would do. They'll try to lobby the government to get financial support. From that point of view, they would lose their independence. Government would dictate that, government would develop mechanisms, and this mechanism would dictate where money goes based on other factors that interferes with the basics of the research itself. Or if there's any change in the government itself, then support for research would fluctuate up and down. And who said that? Carl Compton, he was the president of MIT at the time. He said it in 1934. It's unfortunate that some of the things he feared right now, when you look at certain countries, some of his fears happen up or down to different degrees. But his fears were right. Nevertheless, through his recommendation, he was able to stop the involvement of government supporting research. But 1939, Second World War starts, new weapons develop, you have rockets, you have airplanes, you need radars, you need to detect them, you have submarines, and because of that, people realized that for any country to maintain its independence, they need to have strong foundation of scientific research. And the way the Second World War ended using the nuclear weapon, that even encouraged the government more to look back at this issue. So 1945, President Truman at the time established the first research center in the United States, actually the first research organization, which is the Naval Research Lab. 1950, the Congress started the National Science Foundation to support basic research. After that, other organization kept coming, and that's how United States kept flourishing. When the space war started during the Cold War in the 1950s, and the Soviets launched the satellite Sputnik, United States established NASA to get back into space. AT&T was having a satellite program. They revitalized very quickly, and then within a few years, Telstar came out, and so on. Right now, of course, government is very supportive of research. I will just read this quote from President Obama. There are those who say that we cannot afford to invest in science. The support of research is somehow a luxury at moments defined by necessity. I fundamentally disagree. Science is more essential for our prosperity, our security, our health, our environment, and our quality of life than it has ever been before. If that's how the United States feels about the importance of science and the research and how it impacts a society, then that's how probably the rest of the world should feel as well and invest in their scientific organizations to catch up and to move forward. How does the United States determine future directions for science and technology? There's something called National Science Board that advises the president and advises the research organizations where to go. They perform studies and they identify general directions and they don't hide them. They publish them for everybody. If you want to follow them, you can. And the latest study was done in 2008 to develop what they call National Academy Grant Challenges. When I looked at them, I arranged them as we see here. I put them in three categories. I'll read them very quickly and say what the significance of every category would mean. The first one, make solar energy economical, provide energy from fusion, develop carbon sequestration methods, manage the nitrogen cycle, restore and improve urban infrastructure. That's basically, you could call it energy, renewable energy, and something in that area. The next one, advanced health informatics, reverse engineer the brain, engineer better medicines, provide access to clean water. That's basically health, which is one of the most important factors and economic factors right now worldwide. Third one, secure cyberspace, enhance virtual reality, prevent nuclear terror, advance personalized learning, engineer tools for scientific discovery. That's basically economy and national security. Now, these future general directions, they give them to research organizations to implement them. Now, I'm more focused on my own organization. I'm with the National Science Foundation, and our division is called Electrical Communications and Cyber Systems. It consists of three clusters. The first cluster is called Electronics, Photonics, and Magnetic Devices, and has five program directors. Second one is Communication, Circuits, and Sensing Systems. It has three program directors. Third one is Energy, Power, Control, and Networks, EPCN, and it has three program directors. Our annual funding is about $115 million per year, and we try to leverage these resources by collaborating with other agencies so we can increase our share of research. In general, every cluster, I summarize their interests here. For the first one, electronics, photonics, and magnetic devices, they basically deal with future nanotechnology devices, how to find the best materials for electronic devices, how to make devices themselves better, improve their quality, their operation, and so on. And they touch a little bit of circuits. Then the second cluster, communication circuits and sensing systems, they take it from the circuits, they move to the systems with a little bit of focus on communications, on computer systems, and mostly on sensors and biological applications. The third cluster is energy, power, control, and networks. And of course, it shows they are mostly related to energy and environment. When you look at what goes on in the world of electrical and computer engineering right now, the key technologies that really generate the wealth for the next few years are computing, telecommunications, biotechnology, alternate energy, and nanotechnology. Nanotechnology itself is a helping or supporting field of research, but really prepares for the next phase. Now, very quickly, I'll try to give you introduction to some of the future ideas we have. How much time left for me?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay, I can talk at least about three of them. When you follow what goes on in the world of computers right now, you will notice that over the last almost 10 years, the clock speed of computers is not increasing anymore. It's stuck in the neighborhood of somewhere between 2.5 to 3 gigabit per second. And when you think about the reason, it is not that we do not have faster devices that can operate at higher clock speeds. That's not. It is the heat losses that generated with every clock pulse. The amount of heat generated there, it's so enormous that you cannot have enough heat sinks to extract it out. And because of that, we cannot shrink computers anymore. You cannot increase the clock speed. And for 10 years, it's really a bottleneck. And in general, when we think about how we got there, we use lithography to make most devices. And when you follow what went on from 1980 up to now. In the early 80s, most of the feature size, if you think of it in terms of the gate length or the separation, that's what you use to print, was several wavelengths. And then between 1990 to 2000, it was near wavelength. And then when it went below wavelength, that's when we start hitting the final limit. And in principle, if we were thinking ahead, there was one of the founders of Intel. His name is Gordon Moore. And actually, he was one of the people who started working on integrated circuits after their early inventions in the 50s. You all know the story. Transistors, the research started on them in the late 1940s. And then the first patent that was established was by John Bardeen, who was working at AT&T at the time. And then the Nobel Prize for research that led to discovery of transistors was awarded 1962 to Shockley, Bardeen, and the third one, I don't remember his name. But anyway, the people who left was Bardeen, went to California and worked with him. One of them was Gordon Moore. He split from, was Shockley. Gordon Moore split from Shockley and started something that later on became Intel. And he made an observation based on the lithography technique that we used to make integrated circuits that later on became Moore's law, which says basically that the number of transistors on a chip will double every 2 years just by looking at the lithography and so on. And because of that, when you think about it, gradually, if we keep doubling into every 2 years, at some point we'll hit a physical limit. At that point, our physical limit is not in terms of how small we make the device itself. It's how much heat it generates. And right now, the focus is on what technologies we could use to make sure that we do not generate as much heat as we have right now. And some of the future directions are nanotube devices, graphene transistors, topological insulators, and there are several other research centers that look into this area, from tunneling transistors and so on. Anything that can operate at a higher speed and lower losses. And one of the ways we can reduce losses by operating at lower current levels. Flexible electronics is another important area because of its interaction with either biological applications or military applications. When you have a soldier in the field, he or she, they need to carry so many electronic devices around them. And in order to maximize the amount of electronics they carry, if you can put something flexible, it becomes part of whatever they wear. That's an important part. On the other side is for biomedical applications. There are more and more interaction between electronic device and the human body. And if we keep carrying all these bulky and sturdy elements, it does not really match with the human body. We need something flexible. And that's where flexible electronics is. And just by looking here, for example, I mentioned one example. What you see here is that's a lens, soft lens. One of the things people will wear in their eyes. We supported research. One of the researchers looked at the liquids that come in the eye and tried to use these liquids to measure the glucose concentration in the body. And based on that, they can help the people with diabetics to tell them when to take the next dose of insulin. Here is the sensor. And there is an antenna that radiates or sends the signal out. And that's one of the interactions with the body. You couldn't do that without flexible electronics. And of course, their applications is so many. I will not spend time on them. And that's a future also. And there's a huge investment there. The next phase of these flexible electronics leads to what we call it silk electronics. Right now, most of them are from some sort of plastic-based devices, which means if you put them inside the body, either they will have to stay there, or you need to go back and extract them after they do their job. So the next phase of research is the silk electronics. You put the material there, and within certain period after they do their job, they themselves, they will dissolve and disappear when you don't need them anymore. The Brain Initiative, that's one of the national initiatives determined by the National Science Board. And of course, that's how we do the discovery. And I'll conclude with this graph. It's about energy around the world. Of course, the next wave of resources around the world will be to control three elements: food, water, and energy. If you control them, you control the rest of the world. So energy is very important because it's one of the ways to control power, number one. Number two, because of the way we use fossil fuel right now, we're impacting the environment, as you all know. So working on renewable energy is very important. One of the key elements of renewable energy is the energy coming from the sun. And here you see the concentration of energy from the sun. And now when you look at these dots you have over there, theoretically speaking, if we can make solar cells the size of these dots, and they together, they will generate about 18 terawatt, which is the entire world consumption of energy. If you have these dots, you made it. You don't need any other source of energy. Of course, that's theoretical, because to do that, first, we need to increase the efficiency of solar cells to about 8%. Right now, 8% is achievable, but at the far end of devices. There are different levels of solar cells. I will leave them here. Number one is what we call primarily crystalline and polysilicon materials. Their efficiency is about 10%, but their cost is high, about $300,000 to $400,000 per square meter. The next generation is amorphous silicon and other materials. Their cost is lower, but their efficiency is slightly lower. The higher efficiency solar cells that are available right now, but at a higher cost, which of course a major factor of what we do. I think I better stop here, but I left other applications and other future technology in the presentation, and you can have them from the conference organizers. Thank you again.